Ham Radio Now, episode 106. And we are going to catch up with our last conversation from the Huntsville Ham Fest way back last August. Sorry it's taken so long to get it going. In fact, it's been a pretty long time since the last episode went out. A few excuses. I've been putting together this set in a more permanent fashion, and it took a while to do that. And then just as I was getting ready to record, Wirecast, the program that I use to do this fancy switching, came up with an upgrade. Oh, never upgrade. Well, it promised and has some useful things that I really wanted to have. So I did the upgrade and nothing worked. So it took several days to get that working again. And I wasn't happy with the video I was getting out of the previous version, and I'm still not completely satisfied with the video that I'm getting out of this version. Some problems with the video levels between the cameras and these two cameras that I've got going here, and the video that comes off of the monitor when I switch to an internet feed. So I've still got some things to work out, but I'm as close enough to be able to at least put out this episode. And this time we're going to talk to Bob Inderbitzsen, NQ1R. Bob is the snake oil salesman. I mean, the marketing director. Okay, he says that in the episode. The marketing director for the ARRL. And back at Huntsville, we talked about two things primarily. One is the upcoming national convention for the 100th anniversary of our league, which is coming up in July next year. Up in Hartford, just outside of Newington. Newington's not big enough to host a big convention, but Hartford's got the facilities, so they're up there. I've got the bear.
Okay, bear.
Come on. The bear is bugging me. Scratching on my leg, so the bear becomes the guest host for the episode. You want to say anything to the audience, bear? Got anything to say? No. Bear doesn't talk very much. He makes a little noise every now and then. So the bear is here to remind you, in place of Arvin, who I left sitting over there in the editing area, so I won't bother to go get him now, that Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So stop by the website, hamradionow.tv, if you enjoy this video, and help us out with a contribution. Still looking for 10,000 hams. It's a joke now. 10,000 hams, 10 bucks a year. We're nowhere near that. So I was talking to Bob Inderbitzsen about the upcoming ARRL convention, which is coming up in Hartford. And we also talked about digital QST. And at that point, he was promising that there would be an application out for Android. And it came out in October. In fact, it came out on my birthday. It was a nice little birthday present from ARRL. So you get it from the Play Store, but you can also see some information about it here on their website. There we go. The Android app. So you go to the Google Play Store and pick that up. My Nexus 7 is making some noise, as if to say that we want to demonstrate this. It is out, and this is a Nexus 7, the pure Google experience, and there's the shortcut for the app, which I didn't mean to push. I pushed something else. What I wanted to do was go to the Play Store and type in QST. There it is, sitting there waiting for me. I've already installed it, so it's going to say open, not install. And something else I want to note is if you look down here under the reviews, there's not a lot of reviews. It's just 62 of them, not thousands and thousands. But there's a lot of one-star reviews. So I'm not sure what the problem is. It tends to work pretty well here on the Nexus 7. This first one, this first two-star review says each page does not focus. He has to zoom in a little bit. So I'll actually address that in just a moment. But okay, let's open up the app. Oh, evidently I already looked at some magazine here. All right, let's pick October. The big deal about having the app on Android is now you can download the magazine and look at it offline if you're on an airplane or someplace where you don't have an internet connection. It never worked all that well for me, even on the Nexus 7, with looking at it straight on the internet. But I was looking at it on the ARRL website, and that's probably not the best way to do it. So in any case, it works pretty well with the application either online or by downloading. But I tend to prefer to download stuff just so I don't have to worry about and having an internet connection. The Nexus 7, this one anyway, is not internet connected. It's Wi-Fi. It doesn't have a LTE. It doesn't have a cell phone connection. So if I want to read something, better to have it downloaded on the device. So let's take a look at how it performs. Let's take a look at October. And we come up with the front cover. Is it going to remind me that I can just push a button? Yeah, there we go. Single tap to show or hide the on-screen controls. There they are up on the top. And they will come and go. And the performance is pretty responsive as I switch between pages. Does a pretty good job. You can just slide them back and forth. When you get to a page that's got links on it, like this one does, they highlight for just a moment, and you just tap the story or the link, and off you go to the link. Oh, the back button didn't take me back to the previous page. It took me back out to the menu, so we have to launch this one again. It's also got these icons, the right and left arrows for stepping through the pages. But you have to be careful because just above it is a double arrow, and that will take you to either the last page or at the very end of the magazine, which is always going to be an ad, or the first page, which is going to be the cover. And if you do that, you don't have a path back to where you were. So you have to be careful. Don't hit that accidentally. Let's see, one other thing I wanted to show, and I wanted to do that with the editorial, because I know where to go find that. That guy was talking about when he goes to a page, it's fuzzy and then clears up. And that happens with just about every page you go to, although you're not really seeing it here. But I'll show you why in just a moment. But here's the deal that does still bug me. And I don't think it's anything that the ARRL can do anything about. I think it's just the way that Nextbook, the vendor that makes this stuff, has designed it. Because I see another couple of professional publications that are on the Nextbook format. They work the same way. And I have the same complaint with them. And that is that the zoom level is not as much as I want it to be. And the other complaint about zooming is if I want to see this paragraph and I tap on it and zoom into it, if I'm doing that on a PDF file, that's where I go. If I'm doing it on QST, I go to the center. And that's not where I want to go, so that I have to slide on over. It's not that hard to do, but I still have to slide on over. There's Dave Sumner, ARRL CEO. The zoom level is not as deep as I want it to be. There you can see the fuzziness. Well, that's interesting. It's jumping around now. Not sure why. When you do a zoom, first it gets fuzzy and then it clears up. And I'll show you why that happens in just a minute. So I can't zoom any more than that. And I'd like to be able to. So I suppose if we want to have that function, we could yell at ARRL and they could yell at Nextbook. But since Nextbook is doing that for everybody, I'm not sure we're going to get any resolution. It's an adequate level of zoom. I can read it as you're looking at it on this screen probably looks like it's plenty big enough, but as I show it to myself in reality, it's, from at least for my old eyes, even with progressive lenses on, it's a little bit smaller than comfortable reading. Maybe I'm just used to all the other stuff I read online or whatever, where I can zoom as much as I want, and I make things big because I've got old eyes. All right, let's take a look at the other thing I wanted to show you. We're going to get out of the QST application and go over to this browser. And there are the actual pages, just looking through the file system on the Nexus 7. And here is the page that we were looking at, page 12, the editorial. And what we see are, didn't want to push that button, meanwhile, hit on back, is that there are three pages marked page 12. There's low res, small, and high res. And if you can see, get this a little closer to the monitor, they're all JPEGs. They're pictures. JPEG is a bitmap format. It's not a vector format. It's a picture. So if we go to page 12 low res, now that it's we're looking at the JPEG through a viewer, not through the QST and Nextbook program, we can zoom in a lot more. And you can see that this low res is pretty fuzzy. And since these three pages are all side by side, I can see that the small version is totally fuzzy. It's just there. And I think it's just there so that the Nextbook program can quickly show you something, that you're going somewhere, and get it up fast, especially maybe on tablets that don't have the performance that this Nexus 7 does. This is a pretty high performance tablet. So we've got the really fuzzy one, the less fuzzy one, but still a little bit fuzzier than you'd want, and then finally the sharp one. And Nextbook could zoom in a lot more, even with a JPEG, even though it's not a PDF, that you could zoom in almost infinitely and still stay sharp, at least on text. Won't do that on pictures, of course, but it could do it on text. It could go a lot farther than it is and look better. I suppose I could just sit here and read the magazine the way I want in the JPEG viewer, but then it doesn't have the links, and then going from one page to another, I have to shift through three pages of everything. So that's kind of a pain. So we're way ahead of where we were for those of us in the Android platform. And they've had this out in iOS for about a year. So you guys see something different than those of us on Android do. But at least it's out there, and we can now download and look at QST on our Android tablets. So hooray for that. So now let's head on down to Huntsville, the last episode from the Huntsville Hamfest, and talk to Bob Inderbitzsen and see what's going on and coming up with the ARRL convention. And if you're not planning on going to the convention, and maybe you don't have an Android tablet, it's still a pretty interesting conversation, so you might want to stick around and watch. Let's head on down there. With the prize drawing loud in the background, Ham Radio Now, episode, no, I don't know what episode this is, I can't say that. But we are at the Huntsville Hamfest, and we are going to talk ARRL with Bob Inderbitzsen, NQ1R, still marketing manager?
Still marketing manager.
Not president?
Snake oil salesman.
There isn't a line from marketing manager to president, right?
No, there really isn't.
You're in the business side.
Yeah, I am.
And Kay Craigie is in the political side, I guess you could call it.
And I have deep respect for Kay because she's a volunteer. At least I get paid for the work I do.
Not much, but you get paid a little bit.
That's right.
Well, I've already made fun of your call sign in previous shows.
Yes, you have,
I've tried to figure out how to spell your name right on the lower thirds. So all that business is well behind
us. You pronounce it just fine, so.
All that business is well behind us. We can talk pure ARRL.
Great.
You guys are going crazy, aren't you?
We are. We're approaching a big year. And the ARRL 2014 Centennial is coming down on us very quickly. There's a lot of balls in the air, and we're real excited about all we have planned for next year.
Let's hit the highlights of the important stuff, the dates, the location,
Great. And
then we'll talk about what might be happening.
Great. One of the centerpieces of next year's 100th birthday is the ARRL National Centennial Convention in Hartford, Connecticut. The major dates for the event will be the 17th, 18th, and 19th of July next year. On the 17th, we have training tracks planned. Folks will be able to sit through a public service training track, maybe an antenna or project building training track.
Is that a Friday or a Thursday?
That's a Thursday.
Okay. So it's a Thursday, Friday, Saturday.
Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And we'll have some stuff on Sunday, but that'll largely be tours of ARRL headquarters continuing into Sunday. But most of the convention activities will wind down on Saturday.
Okay.
So Thursday's training tracks. Friday and Saturday, we have a proper exhibit hall, forums and presentations, a grand banquet and general session planned for Friday night, and a closing ceremony on Saturday. All throughout the entire time of the convention, there'll be shuttle buses that will take individuals down to ARRL headquarters, 15 minutes away from Hartford, by bus to enjoy tours of headquarters and the Hiram Percy Maxim Memorial Station.
What does a tour of the station entail for this event? Is it going to be truncated from what you'd get if you just wandered by any given Tuesday?
Yeah, I mean, I can promise you that there'll be a lot of people there, but we do want people to be on the air. I mean, half the fun of visiting W1AW is getting on the air. So we'll figure out some way to push a lot of people through the station. There's three visitor studios that are fixed studios filled with great equipment on site there. But we'll figure out some way to get a lot of people on the air.
Yeah, you got to distribute the on-the-air activity among multiple bands. You can't have three stations on 20 meters.
That's right. But the station's set up quite nicely to operate with multiple visitors at any given time, and there's multiple towers on the property. It's a well-equipped station, so it'll be great fun.
Yes, I've been there. It's like a little mini Voice of America.
It is. It's great fun. And the bulletin station is right across from the visitor studios. You can see all the transmitters and amplifiers used for the bulletins as well.
Yeah. Do they run bulletins on weekends?
I don't know the schedule off the top of my head.
Because I'm wondering if they have to shut down the guest operation when the bulletins are running.
That's right. That's correct.
Because they would just kind of blow you away. They're in every band.
And who knows? Maybe during the centennial, maybe they'll be operating under slightly different schedules so that because of the large number of people on the property. But it's going to be a party, and we're really looking forward to it. So plan to come for the centennial. Plan to come as early as that Thursday, July 17th, to participate in the all-day training tracks. We got some
Any ideas of what they're going to involve now?
Yeah, we're hoping a public service track, a technical track, maybe project building, maybe something on microcontroller technology. Antennas is always popular. There's some talk about whether or not we'll have an amateur radio licensing class. There's a lot in the being sort of discussed and planned right now, and a lot of interest in supporting the event. So if you're a ham radio operator in the Connecticut, New England, New York State region, and you want to volunteer for a part of the event, go to ARRL2014.org and look for the link to volunteer. We could use a lot of help at the event.
Okay, there's going to be a flea market.
The proper exhibit hall will be Friday and Saturday. It's a great downtown convention facility. We'll have ARRL will have a big chunk of real estate on the exhibit hall floor. We'll have
of a little ARRL expo.
Little
like
exposition.
You do
at Dayton. Yep. We'll have manufacturers.
Why not? You own the place.
that's right. We've already paid the bill. So, and we'll have manufacturers and vendors there, just like here at the Huntsville Ham Fest. We'll have a good turnout. We've already got commitments from a lot of great manufacturers and vendors. An indoor flea market. It's July in the summertime in Connecticut. It's usually quite nice and fair, but if it becomes real hot, we're in an air-conditioned
or
facility.
Rains a lot.
Or
yeah.
Rains, who knows.
Yeah. So is the flea market in one building and the vendors in another?
Nope,
Huntsville. Yeah, like here at Huntsville, we're in one big building.
Yep.
They've got these red drapes around part of it.
That's
where
right.
The people who have paid a lot of money to sit in this spot, except for me, because they give it to me for free this year. So that's, you know, more commercialish. And then just down the aisle where you can't see off camera is I don't think we can see it off camera. This is your usual trashy flea market.
Yeah, I think we'll see all of that. And we'll also see a lot of clubs, organizations, and international societies come in from around the world who will likely want to represent themselves at this once-in-a-lifetime event. So I'm excited about it. We've got commitments from the Radio Society of Great Britain, the German DARC will be represented there. And I imagine many other societies are making plans already. And even if you don't have a booth at the event, I think there'll be a large amount of travelers coming in from all across the United States, but all around the world as well. It's preceded by the WRTC event, which is the sort of Amateur Radio Olympics, which will be held in the Boston area. That event winds down, and it has a huge international scope. And we already have commitments from a lot of that group
Let's not leave people with an acronym that they may not understand.
Yeah. World Radio WRTC, it's a competition.
Yeah, it's a contest. I think I know a little bit about it, but you can probably fill in. It's multiple stations all set up as identically as they can across a geographic area.
That's right.
A couple hundred miles or within 100 miles?
Yeah, I understand it's going to be in the Boston region, so that's confined to that area.
Yeah.
But
similar antennas, similar power levels, similar equipment.
That's right.
So the competition then becomes operating procedure, not station.
That's correct. It's very much a skill set of rules. And a 59, I believe, is the number of stations. So you can imagine bringing 59 teams in from around the world, the large volunteer effort that organization's going through in order to bring all that excitement to Boston.
Yeah. And that's the weekend before?
The week before. It takes place over. And it takes place, the actual competition takes place during the IARU International Contest.
So it's embedded in that contest.
Yes, that's correct.
I mean, there's nothing special about them in the contest. They're just contest participants.
That's right. They're contest participants.
But if you look them up, you'll know who they are.
That's right.
Do they have special call signs in any way?
You know, I don't actually know but it'll be very exciting to have that much amateur radio brain trust in the Boston area.
Yeah. So they'll be around, and then they'll be at the
Why not finish up that competition and then celebrate with the rest of the organization in Hartford?
Okay. At the forums and stuff, is there more focus on ARRL activities, things that you won't see at other ham fests?
Yeah, I mean, it'll have an ARRL flavor, but part of the importance of ARRL is aggregating good information and content and skill and training for the amateur radio community. So expect the type of programming that you would find at a good amateur radio convention. We should hit on all the major underpinnings of the organization, which would include advocacy, technology, education. And there'll be plenty of talk about ARRL membership, but I think we'll be preaching to the choir in Connecticut.
Yeah, it's probably true. A convention hotel?
Yeah, the convention is attached to a Marriott facility, but there is a pile of hotels in downtown Hartford. We will secure some great discounts on hotels in the region, so you could be downtown or just outside of downtown, whatever your pleasure is. I expect that we'll have a list of those discount codes on the ARRL website by about late summer. And registration for the convention will probably open up towards the end of this year.
Okay, so not open yet.
Not open yet. We'll probably open it up 7 months or so before the event.
Is Hartford close to enough tourist stuff that people want to bring some family along to?
Yeah, I mean, the hard part for me is I'm not going to be able to do all the fun things that a visitor will be able to do when they come into New England. First of all, July in New England is just a beautiful time.
Let me interrupt just a moment to say that if your family are not hams, why not?
Why not?
Okay,
that's right.
Now back to the tour.
And maybe they'll become a ham while they're at the convention. Yeah, it's Hartford is located in a nice location between Boston and New York, so we can be serviced by all the airports and transportation of those two cities, and we have an international airport in Springfield called Bradley International Airport.
Now, are those cities close enough to get to for somebody who's staying at the convention but wants to go do it, you know, a family wants to go do a tour, can they get to New York in how long?
Yeah, from the Hartford area, you can take a train into New York City and be in there in just a couple of hours. For Boston, many of us in the Hartford area drive about an hour and a half to Boston, park, and enjoy Boston's great transportation system. So, of course, we want you to stay at the convention during Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, but family members who are really not interested in the event will find that there's lots to do, and New York City and Boston are terrific day trips. We also have in Hartford proper the Mark Twain, the Harriet Beecher Stowe Center, the Wadsworth Athenaeum.
There's a
lot of things to do downtown Hartford. There's also, for those who enjoy radio, there's an antique wireless museum not far from ARRL headquarters and the convention. So that group has planned some things. And adjacent to the convention center and the hotel is the Connecticut Science Center. And it's a premier science, hands-on science center that will young people, older folks, everyone will really enjoy that. And expect that there'll be some sort of discount tickets to the Science Center.
So plenty to do besides just the...
And I haven't even covered the restaurants. I love to eat in downtown Hartford. So there's also movie theaters and all sorts of things right within walking distance of the new convention center facility.
So you know that here at Ham Radio Now, we're not afraid to tackle the dark side.
That's right.
I have heard that Hartford is suffering economically. New England Rust Belt. The Midwest is the Rust Belt, I guess. But, you know, there's been flight, populations down, things like that. What's Hartford's status these days?
Yeah.
They'd like to have you there, boost the economy, things like that.
Oh, most definitely. You know, the last 10 years, Hartford has spent a lot of money on both downtown revitalization. The area that the ARRL convention will be in is a riverfront area right on the Connecticut River, which runs all the way from up well above Connecticut, well north of Connecticut, all the way down to the Long Island Sound. So it's a great walking area. There's usually jazz festivals and all sorts of activities down there. But they've undergone a significant revitalization. There's some colleges in the area. Trinity's not far from there. UConn's expressed some interest in coming in. The University of Hartford's got a downtown campus. So there's a lot of young people also that spend a lot of time. It is sort of a bedroom community, though. Folks tend to leave Hartford and live in most of the suburbs. Although,
like Newington.
Yeah, like Newington, yep. Although there is a large skyscraper in downtown Hartford that's relatively new, and it's brought in a lot of people to live in this big, huge skyscraper downtown Hartford. So it's a beautiful city. We really like it. It looks great. The infrastructure has improved a lot over the years. And if you've been to Hartford, say, 15 or 20 years ago, it's a different place today.
Okay, so it's been through some trouble, like a lot of cities.
And if the mayor of Hartford's listening, I hope I get my cut for tourism.
Well, he did a nice dodge of a nice job of dodging the really hard part of the question. That's what we expect.
Yeah, but
I ask you, answer what you want.
That's right. But it's a great downtown area. We're gonna have a lot of fun, and it's mostly an insurance industry that's downtown. Got Travelers and the Aetna, and they all still have significant presences in downtown Hartford.
Yep. I have to apologize for something. I'm from Raleigh.
Ah.
We stole your hockey team.
Yeah, you did.
It was the Hartford Whalers.
The Whalers. Yeah, the Whalers. And you know, and there's a lot of people who just will never forgive that.
Yeah, and it wasn't a AAA. I mean, it was in the NHL.
Yeah. Yep.
So we got it in Raleigh.
Yeah, now I think we have the Whales. I think that's the team we were left with. So, but we're really proud of our Whales.
So they went to Raleigh. They changed the name to the Hurricanes.
Okay.
And they won the Stanley Cup after a couple of years.
Yep.
And then, of course...
Yeah.
But
Well, expect that you'll see some folks walking around downtown Hartford with Whalers T-shirts on.
Okay,
because,
so don't wear my Raleigh.
The fan base has not let it go.
don't wear anything indicating I'm from Raleigh.
That's right.
Could be in trouble. All right, so anything else about the convention people ought to know? Once again, the dates are...
July 17th to the 20th, 2014.
Thursday. For forums, for special track of forums.
Yep.
Friday and Saturday.
Exhibit and hall and all-day presentations around the clock.
And then come on Sunday.
Sunday we'll continue tours of ARRL headquarters as people start checking out of hotels and begin planning the rest of their destinations in New England.
ARRL headquarters itself, across from WNAW, is an office building.
A lot of paper, a lot of people.
I was going to say it's dumpy. And I say that with all due respect and love, because you aren't spending our dues on a glass tower, magnificent,
gorgeous architecture. I'm quite proud of my 1960s office furniture. And you know, some of that stuff has started to come into being retro again. So I'm glad we hung on to it.
I haven't been there in a few years. You might have polished things up a little.
There's a lot of people and paperwork and that type of thing. We have a beautifully renovated lobby a few years ago and a great front bookstore. And folks come from
the area.
There's
a little museum in the lobby, if I recall.
You know, we've moved a lot of the museum pieces around the building in cabinetry that sort of adorns the hallways. But the ARRL Laboratory has taken on a project where they've built a small history of wireless, amateur radio wireless museum right on the property. It's a small space, but it's filled with a lot of stuff. And there are four or five operating positions there. I say operating positions because they are entirely capable of getting on the air with this equipment. But they're done by decades. So you can see an amateur radio station, say, from the 20s. You can see a station from the 40s, the 60s, the 90s. And then there's cabinetry there housing a lot of really vintage equipment. A lot of equipment that's been donated to the organization. We are not a museum curator, but it's a nice side part of the tour when folks come through headquarters to be able to see, that's what a station looked like when I came into amateur radio, or is that what it looked like in 1920?
little tear in the corner of people's eye, I imagine.
That's right, and people like to sit in front of the operating positions and get their picture taken in front of a spark gap transmitter.
Yeah, now the spark gap's not operational. I don't imagine the rest of the stuff is on.
Yeah, there's not a lot, but there is some stuff that is, and there's we've also got some AM equipment that's been donated to the organization, and a lot of it is all. That's right, that's right. Joe Walsh had donated some equipment to the organization, so it's a very nicely done small exhibit. But if you like that type of thing, folks will spend a lot of time in that hallway enjoying the equipment.
Okay. One other thing I want to talk about a little bit, maybe you've got some other things you'd like to bring up. Brand new Google Nexus 7.
Yes, yes. Save room for the QST app. It's coming.
Well, I was going to ask about that because this is replacing an old Kindle Fire.
Yes.
I could dial up the website and look online when I was on Wi-Fi and see QST digitally.
That's right.
But the experience left something to be desired.
Okay.
It basically sucked. I couldn't get from one page to another very well. It would be slow and laggy.
Sure.
I thought it was the Kindle Fire. I brought the same thing up on here, and it's better, but it's still, if I want to move from one place to another, I move my finger, and I go to get lunch, and 3-4 seconds,
yep.
and then things move. So that ain't so good.
So it's time to upgrade your network service, Gary, because that's not the experience our members are really having with
on
it.
On these kind of things?
On those type of things.
Okay.
There's a mobile-optimized browser version that works on nearly any device that's out there.
I may be just using the website.
Yeah, and it has quite nice access. However, we all know that having an app is a much better way to enjoy e-magazine technology on a device.
And being able to download so that you can use it when you're away from the
connection.
That's
right. And, of course, our iOS Apple users already have that ability with an app for QST on their devices. And the Android one is coming very shortly. I'm in the process of participating with a team that are beta testing it. I already have it on my Android Motorola device. It's working great. We're testing it on Galaxies. That's a really popular device as well. And it will be available very soon. Might be just a couple of weeks at this point.
Wow.
You'll be able to download the entire magazine and all of the audio and video files embedded with a particular issue right onto your device. I have a number of friends who travel internationally for work, and they'll drop me a message, and they'll say, "Hey, Bob, I'm enjoying September QST at London Heathrow Airport on my iPad." Well, expect that you'll be able to do that very shortly on the Android devices.
Yay.
Yep.
Hooray for parody.
Finally. Boy, that Apple versus everyone else thing just keeps happening out there, though. So for publishers like us who are doing this in a way that hasn't cost members any more money, it's been difficult navigating the e-publishing marketplace. And picking the right vendors who can offer the right scope of services. But our platform uses Nextbook, and we've been pretty satisfied with that.
In general, how has the digital QST thing been going over?
Yep. Phenomenally. While I'd like to think all of our members think about ARRL at least once a day, for many members, it's QST in the mailbox once a month where they're really reminded about their membership with the association. Now, with the digital edition, mid-month, members get an email announcement that the digital edition is available. So we have this other opportunity to remind folks about their relationship with ARRL. It's been going very, very well. We've already had thousands of members voluntarily opt out of receiving their print edition copy in order to just enjoy the digital edition. And for many members, they're very happy that we didn't threaten to take away the print edition at all.
Ham Radio's got a divide. A lot of old people who are just old, a lot of old people who are thinking young, and then a small handful of young people like yourself.
Yeah, and you know, technical content, I think, lends itself very well to the printed page still. You know, you can pick up that magazine and look at a schematic and turn it around and move it around.
For all of the capability of doing that, if you really need that schematic, you can print it.
You can print it.
You got a printer.
Exactly. So for some folks, they like the printed page and will continue to do it that way as long as there's interest in a printed publication, and there are plenty today.
Okay. So are you happy with the number of people that are using it?
Existence? Yeah, the penetration into ARRL membership is really quite significant. But it's also providing us with a lot of background information about readers' preferences. If we see that a lot of readers are opening up a particular project, we'll produce more projects like that. If we find that there's a particular narrative, a public service story that's very popular, a story about a local group that's done something great, we'll put more of that in the magazine.
So you've got some granular data coming in about looking at what and how much they're looking
and
at.
And it's aggregated in a way that we don't know on a member-by-member basis because we're respecting the privacy of our readership. However, in mass, we know what people are reading, which is fantastic data for those of us who are trying to improve QST all the time.
Is that going to lead to more of the really popular stuff and then the more niche stuff is going to be left behind?
Well, yeah, that's a good question.
Probably can't afford to do that.
No, you know, QST is supposed to cover all of the underpinnings of amateur radio. There is sometimes content in there that is above the technical expertise of some of the amateur radio community. But if we don't include that, then we don't lift the skill set of some of our community that likes to contribute to the radio art in a more significant way. If we don't put public service articles in the magazine, we won't keep sharing the story about how different groups are improving on a local level the type of training and the type of way they've organized public service communications in their community. We need to do all of that, even if sometimes the readership is small. So we're going to continue to stir all the pots with QST, but we're going to use this data to take advantage of what we know about readers' preferences.
Okay. So as long as we're talking
So basically, Gary, I told you we're going to do it all.
Yeah, you're still going to keep doing it all. But you'll see if there's something that's really piquing people's interest, you might add.
That's right. And let's face it.
It still takes a while to produce it, so you won't edit an article next month based on this month, but next year.
Yeah, and of course the digital magazine gives us the chance to put multimedia content in there, video and audio, and if we find that an article lends itself better to including an explanation of a project or an explanation of a product review, expect to find a video and expect to see more of that as we get better with those capabilities.
So those are extensions that you can do, that you are doing.
Yes.
Constraints in the physical magazine are just the number of pages you can afford to print. Those constraints don't exist digitally.
They don't.
There's how much you can afford to create.
Yes.
Which may not be much more than you could afford to print. But at the moment, you are keeping things the same in the digital version as the print version, except for the multimedia content that you add. But you don't have the option at this point to say, well, I can give this article on this radio review or whatever a page and a half, 3 pages in the magazine, but I could do a 6 pages on, because I write radio reviews for QST.
Sure.
I've got one coming up in the October issue.
Okay.
And I write longer stuff than they can use.
Right.
And then I write them a shorter version they could run the longer version digitally, but they're not doing that yet.
Well, it's not so much, a good publisher with a good editing team will make sure that we've assembled content that can be digested in a monthly journal to its members. So one thing you're not going to find is that we're just going to throw in everything and the kitchen sink into the digital edition just for the sake of publishing it, because we start to dilute the interest that we have, and that is every month the organization takes a snapshot of the state of amateur radio, and we try to cover as much of that as we can in one month, and if we do too much, then we dilute the effectiveness of that. And then some people just say, wow, you know, that's just, it's just too much content. That has always been
one of... I hear that complaint about Ham Radio Now, Noah.
Well, you know, for ARRL, that's been one of our mantras since well before I was ever at the organization. If you're a good publisher and a good editor, sometimes you're selective about the content that you include in your publication. We believe we have a great team that does that today.
Yeah.
And we'll do that for the digital edition as well as any way that you find QST content digested.
So the digital edition is timed to come out about when the paper edition reaches mailboxes.
Yeah.
I usually see it maybe a day ahead.
Yeah, I can actually give you the inside scoop on that. Our magic date is the 15th of every month. If the 15th falls on a Thursday when the ARRL letter comes out, expect that we'll go out with the digital QST announcement the day before. We try not to flood your mailbox with both the ARRL letter and the digital QST announcement on the same day. So we stay away from Thursdays, and we often stay away from a weekend. If the 15th falls on a weekend, we'll do it on Friday. Most of that is because some of our users are brand new every month into the digital edition, and sometimes people require some assistance with figuring out their website logins or their usernames, or they forget their password, and we want to be able to offer them support before we shut the lights off on Friday afternoon.
So things aren't working.
That's right. There's somebody they can talk to by phone, and that's important for us. We offer a high amount of support by phone to members.
Yeah. And plus, you want to get it on a Friday so you can
have the whole weekend enjoying it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You don't want it to arrive Sunday afternoon.
So always the 15th or earlier, not the 15th or later. We won't go later than the 15th.
Okay. But the digital folks are going to want a bigger bone someday with the ability to put it out as soon as you're done. And not wait for those old laggard print edition people.
Yep.
You probably hear that now and then. Why can't I get my digital edition as soon as it's done?
Why can't we be more timely with content? Why does it have to take 3 months to get something in the magazine?
Of course, you've got timely content every day on the website.
On the website and the weekly ARRL letter. So again, for a publisher like us, it's important to have multiple vehicles so that we can deliver today timely content on a daily basis, on a breaking news basis, on a weekly basis. And again, even with the ARRL letter, it's important that we digest content on a weekly basis, try to cover the whole scope of what's going on, but not throw everything in. Otherwise, you lose readership. They just say, oh boy, you know, there's no... They just include everything, and that's not fair to the readers either.
Yeah, I need my content curated a little bit.
Yeah, so we think hard about what's on the first page, just like a newspaper would.
Yep. Across the general scope of publications, print is falling away. Newsweek is gone. In the computer industry, PC Magazine and now PC World are all gone. Not gone from print, online editions. So even digging into the more niche interests, the very niche interests like ham radio. Let's see, at the bottom end, World Radio went all online. Monitoring Times just is announced ceasing publication. I'm sure you're looking at that.
Well, we're looking at how to be most effective with the small amount of dues. You know, ARRL dues haven't gone up in 13 years. So that's a long time to not have a dues increase during an economy where many organizations either went out of business, lost members, or had to increase because of increasing costs. If anything, we've added more benefits during that period of time. It's a game that we play to try to figure out how to stretch those dollars and maximize the amount of penetration that members have into benefits and services all the time. That said, there'll be a dues increase at some point in the future, just like any organization will, and we'll make decisions about what basic dues include. Right now, we don't want to be the leader in deciding whether e-magazine technology is the way to go exclusively. We've taken a more conservative role and offer members both options. For many businesses who are much larger than us as publishers, who have gone e-only, it's also been the end of their publishing circulation base. We certainly don't want that. If we're deeply engaged right now with members on a print level, expect that we'll continue to print that printed magazine for many years to come.
The foreseeable future.
Right? Foreseeable future. Could
you don't
could
have
we...
a committee working on shutting down QST?
No, right? Not at all. It's our number one benefit, and it's a number one benefit because of the printed magazine. So okay. to quickly make that decision to go digital only would be a disaster for ARRL, and there's no planning of such a nature at all right now.
But you have also not found it economically unfeasible to do both.
That's right. That's right. And part of that has been we tighten our belts all the time, and I keep enjoying that 1960s office furniture in my department. And you know what? It's not actually as expensive to put the magazine out in a digital format. The expense is really finding opportunities to get more authors and more people writing for amateur radio. And then actually doing a good job of editing and assembling that material. So if you want more content in QST, that comes with some expense, whether it's dollars and cents or whether it's opportunity. There are not a lot of people out there writing for amateur radio as maybe there had been 25 or 30 years ago. But there's emerging interest groups right now in amateur radio where we're finding some real exciting new authorship. I think, for instance, of the recent ARRL publication, Arduino and Pickaxe book, ARRL's Ham Radio for Arduino and Pickaxe, edited by Lee Klotz. Lee's dabbling in, at a significant level, in microtechnology at the Pickaxe and Arduino level, knows that community very well, and located a lot of people who could contribute projects to that book. That's a brand new base for us, but it gave us the chance to publish a really good book and excite more people into trying micro
Those devices are very small processors.
Yes.
Very small computers. Because we have an audience that maybe you've heard those things but don't know very much about them. It's a very specialty niche.
Yes.
But it's also the forward-looking side of ham radio.
That's right. And it's a resurgence of project building. Once again, there's a very effective way to get components into people's hands that are really powerful, that integrate with our computers and our laptops. So you're doing a little bit of assembly on a circuit board, you're doing a little bit of coding on a PC, on a computer, and then you're soldering that all together and putting it in a chassis, and you've got a project. Yeah. And it might be an APRS device so that you could track the location of your vehicle on a amateur radio connected map. Or it might be a QRP radio, low power radio, to be able to communicate over DX distances. It's amazing what they're doing with these small microprocessors.
So the specialty books like that one, are they getting into electronic publishing as well, or are you still just making a soft copy book?
Yeah, I'd like to think our marketplace is really, really huge. amateur radio is a niche of its own, and we're starting to put some books out, like our license manuals. Our Q&A books, for instance, are available on Kindle through the Amazon marketplace. But our base isn't particularly big as somebody who's producing fiction or novels and putting them out in the marketplace. So we're starting to do more of that. But now our marketplace is print.
It's kind of like it's coming at you from two ends. The big publishers are publishing digitally and leaving hard copy books, not totally behind, but they're focusing on digital.
Yep.
From the other end, the very micro publishers or self publishers, all digital because they don't have to any expense in doing actual print. You're somewhere in the middle, it sounds like.
Yeah, we are. And we want to make sure that we have a foot. We already have a foot in the print side. There's no question there. We got more toes in the digital side than we did a few years ago. And the importance there is if something happens like the audio industry did, where all of a sudden your record shops were gone and everything was on an MP3 marketplace.
Yeah.
We want to make sure that if that happens with print, that we're not left as the dinosaurs in the publishing world because we don't know how to produce digitally. We know how to produce digitally. The question now is how much of our membership, how many of our publishing customers prefer that as their reading preferences.
Yeah.
And we're following that very closely. That's all we're about these days is how best to adapt to reader preferences.
Yeah. And what we'd like to point everything at the kids who only do the digital stuff. You can't.
Yeah, and I have a 13-year-old daughter who enjoys printed books. She's not reading
She's weird.
She's not reading anything on a tablet or on an iPad. She's playing apps and games and surfing the web on all those devices, but she likes curling up with a book.
Yeah. Well, we interviewed Patrick, the new Young Ham of the Year.
Yes.
And I was detecting in him what I call old soul. He likes analog. He likes HF. He does computers and all that stuff.
Sure.
He's very sharp with it, but he likes to see where we've been. So
yes.
Boy, a lot of us are staying back there where we've been.
Well, you know, if you want to read a really neat article, September 1927 QST has a great article in it by Hiram Percy Maxim, the founder of the organization. And, you know, members can access our archive of QST right on the ARRL website by logging into the site and going to the full archive. But try that search. Go to September 1927 QST and pull up Maxim's article in that issue. And it's a great story about ARRL and the state of amateur radio with a few years under his belt in amateur radio. Well, we're waxing on a lot about that as we approach our centennial year. What's the state of amateur radio? Where are we going? What's our second century going to look like? What will publishing look like in our second century? What will the organization look like? What will licensing look like? So this is an opportunity to sort of take stock of what's working well, where we came from, and the bigger front windshield is where are we going?
Yeah.
And I'm really excited about that.
Let me ask a tough question then. Does amateur radio have a whole second century?
It does. It does. You know, we're bound together by a fragile, very expensive infrastructure that is largely wire-based infrastructure. As much as I'd like to say it's all wireless, go to the back room of any IT room, and you've got the cables either under the floor, between the network boxes. It's a big, fragile infrastructure. And there's a lot more redundancy than there was a few years ago. But we know that when you have a radio and a radio and the magic between them, we can make up that communication distance very easily with very low technology. And there will always be a need to have a community of people who can put that technology in place quickly when all else fails.
Yeah, there'll be the need, but will there be the interest?
I think there will be. I think there'll be where we're seeing some of the interest in technology today is say software engineers and hardware engineers who enjoy being immersed in the technology in their careers, but aren't getting enough of it there, and they're dabbling in it and contributing to the radio art as ham radio operators. I have a large number of friends who have backgrounds having worked with NASA, and they're in their early 40s now. Some of them had disappeared with their interest in amateur radio as they established families, but now they've got some time. They got a whole lot of experience, and they're contributing again to the radio art in a significant way. I think it's exciting where we're going, especially with microcontrollers, satellite communications. There's going to be a lot of opportunity for hams in the future. And there'll be a need to have if you go back to the basis and premise of the amateur radio service, there'll be a need for all of that, contributing to the radio art, contributing to public service, the international goodwill that a lot of us don't think about too much, but every time we talk to another country on the air, we break down barriers and we break down differences just by communicating with each other. Can the kids do that on Skype today? Sure. But we have a common denominator when we're speaking to each other on radio. We have the love of wireless communication and the service. It's a fantastic.
That's a good review of the party line.
Yeah,
and you do it well, and I don't fault you for it. The things that I'm trying to find are, and we won't have time to do it in this show, are what lies behind all of those things.
Yeah,
like telling somebody in Qatar that they are 5'9". We'll make them feel nice for a minute, but it doesn't establish an international rapport between me and them.
But what it does is it assists both operators on both ends of the microphone with establishing both their skill set, how well their equipment is operating, their readiness if they had to use their equipment in the line of country or for an emergency. In this country, we're racked by hurricanes and tornadoes, and so there's a huge public service. So what do you do in between all those emergencies? You make sure you're ready. And you have fun by talking to the guy in Qatar.
Well, and maybe you could learn how they get ready and what kind of problems they have. But I just don't hear that much of it going on. So that's one of the things I'm going to try to keep asking. And once again, we can't do that here show. But I'll keep asking to peel back a layer of that onion beyond our glossy PR. And the ARRL is willing to do that, but I got to keep digging at you.
Yeah, well, and it's an organization that's has a small staff, but it has a huge volunteer base. So there are many people contributing to the second century of amateur radio, from the people who are doing microcontrollers to the nurses who, in some universities, are required as part of their nursing license to get an amateur radio license. I mean, it's fascinating to see how amateur radio is permeating different parts of our culture.
Yeah, I haven't heard about that, and I look forward to
It's exciting
to see how that works out. Now that they are allowed to, in their job, use amateur radio for a brief period of testing and training every week and every year to figure out how our service and our equipment and infrastructure can actually help them, rather than just saying, it's out there. I hope it works the day the stuff hits the fan.
Yep. Well, you and I both know that just sitting in front of a microphone and putting some headphones does not a good operator make. But ham radio operators...
Makes a good television
show,
right. Though.
But ham radio operators have a one-up on that because it's part of the skill set that we learn.
Yeah.
How to speak on a microphone, how to use that equipment that's been put in front of you. Imagine being thrown in that situation in an emergency and you have this big fancy radio, this big... Even if it's commercial and you haven't used it before.
Yeah.
Well, amateur radio operators do that.
All right. Well, I am going to do my absolute best to be up there at the convention.
Great. Come to the party.
Yeah, it sort of depends on the support I get from Ham Radio Now viewers, because frankly, I'm out of money. My bank account is about as low as I'm willing to let it get.
Help Ham Radio Now.
Yeah, and I'm doing that Kickstarter. We didn't talk about Tapper, but a lot of the new stuff is out of the, and it is the ARRL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference that is coming up in. Toward the end of next month, in September, and 4 out of 5 years I've been out and shot video of that. By the way, I'd like the ARRL to promote that a little better for me. I haven't gotten the juice from the league that I think I should have.
Yeah.
In terms of just people saying it's there.
Sure, sure. I know staff like Steve Ford, the editor of QST, are big promoters of that particular conference, and we'll have to talk some more, Gary, to make sure that it's in front of everybody, because that's a great opportunity.
Yeah. So I'm putting the screws to Bob now.
Yeah, yeah.
But I've got a Kickstarter out there to help fund this year. I have to now, because I just can't afford to go out there on my own. So give it a try.
And at next year's convention, there'll be a lot of smaller national-level ham radio associations that'll consider coming out and having their national meetings in Hartford, too. So if you're associated with a radio club that has a national level scope because of your interest area, consider holding your meeting next year in Hartford. It's a great way to get everyone to the party, but it's also a great opportunity for your group to meet together.
Yeah, reminds me briefly of something I forgot to ask, which is you're getting associated activities like especially the Dayton Hamvention, but even here at Huntsville, there are groups that have evening activities that are not official conference, official Hamfest activities, but they're there because the hams are there.
That's right.
And they get promoted by the main event. Dayton didn't used to do that very well. Now they embrace those extra activities and publicize them. So you're looking for those too.
Yeah, I mean, we won't feel threatened at all if you decide to have your national meeting coattailing in conjunction with the ARRL Centennial Convention. So
yeah.
It's about
or a banquet or a talk or
that's right, and we'll build in lots of opportunity in the scheduling to make sure that your schedule is not so filled that there's some dinner or something that you have to do for ARRL all the entire time, because we want people to socialize and get together and enjoy being together. together. So,
are you planning a banquet type thing, keynote speaker sort of activity?
Friday night of the event.
Okay.
Yep. So Friday night, notch that one out. But the rest of the event, you're really open to because we know that the DX groups and the groups like Tapper, they often like to get together while they're in town for large conventions, and we want to provide lots of opportunity for them to do so.
Yeah. And your banquet, how many people will that be able to hold?
The
rubber chicken circuit.
Lots. I don't even think...
Not everybody, but...
That's right. I mean, I'm hoping that we have a 500 to 1,000 person banquet for that Friday night, and the facility can accommodate that. And if it goes beyond that, we'll figure out... That's a happy problem that I'm happy to figure out.
Okay. And you don't have a lineup for that yet?
We do not, but we're working that angle right now, and I expect that we'll have national level speakers and entertainment
get somebody prominent
for the event.
I'll volunteer.
Thanks, Gary. Yeah, we'll put you on.
what I'll volunteer for is to videotape it or maybe even stream it. So.
I appreciate that. There'll be a lot of opportunity for people to help out with the event. So.
We'll see. We'll talk about that.
Great.
All right. Thank you, Bob.
Yeah. Thank you, Gary.
Looking forward to the convention, and we will talk again soon. And for Ham Radio Now, let's go to the wide shot, and we'll let Bob wrap up the program along with me. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Bob, NQ1R.
Over and out. And out.